Also found tombs nearby from the later Hyksos period. That'd be 1650 to 1500 BC.
Okay.
When Western Asian migrants took over the country, putting an end to Egypt's Middle Kingdom. Egyptian archaeologists working on the Nile Delta uncovered dozens of rare pre-Dastanic. All right, that's before the dynasties.
Okay.
All right, that's, I think the way you say that is dynastic, right?
All right.
Pre-dynastic tombs dated to the period before Egypt's pharaoh kingdoms started. That emerged more than 5,000 years ago.
And what did they find?
Well, they found people in tombs.
Yeah,
in
well,
some cases,
I think that's
little babies. Little babies.
Supposed to be there.
Well, I know that, but it's rare to find them that old. Western Asia.
Still alive? Or what?
No, no, there. It's their remains.
The remains are there, yeah.
But they know that they're Asian rather than Egyptian.
Ah.
Which is interesting.
Yeah, that is interesting.
So, you know, we learn more and more and more about our history all the time. And I like that.
Could they have been aliens?
That's a possibility.
Yeah.
I don't know. They said Asians, but they probably were aliens in the traditional sense of aliens, meaning that they weren't from where they were.
Yeah.
Right? You know what I'm saying? I mean, a lot of us...
But if they were just visiting, why would anybody have built the...
No, I think that they may have set up a kingdom there.
Yeah.
That put an end to Egypt's Middle Kingdom, and then eventually there was the rise of the pharaohs, which put an end to the Middle Asian kingdom that took place in Egypt. Would that be the Middle Asian Egypt kingdom then? I'm not certain. I don't know how that goes exactly.
They did have one good year. They finished third in the National League, as I recall.
That could be. Yeah. The U.S. has set a record for air travel. Over 1.6 million people in the United States had set another record for the number of air travelers.
Was that like this week or?
Since the pandemic. Yeah. That was on, get this, nearly 1.67 million people were screened at U.S. airport checkpoints on Sunday.
Wow.
Just on Sunday.
Just on Sunday.
According to the Transportation Security Administration, that was the highest number screened since March 12th. Of the 2020, the year of the pandemic. And so it's still 35% below the number of airport travelers reported on a comparable Sunday of 2019. But the numbers are going up because the restrictions are going down. And in some ways, all right, in some ways, and maybe not a very fair way. So you might have to explain to me or to our listeners if it is a fair way. But in some ways, it's almost a representation of government and its restrictions, all right? As the restrictions go up, the increased activity in the world around it, right? But now, with travel restrictions going up, so increased activity to travel, right? You think it holds true with regulations in other things too?
Well, in some cases, yeah.
And maybe not in all cases. I don't know.
Speaking of travel, a guy named Tory Gray was moving from Alabama to Florida to a new home.
Right. Okay.
And he's on the interstate and he sees this vehicle ahead of him swerve to avoid a great horned owl.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Wow.
And he said, boy, that was close. And he continued on and drove to Florida.
Mm-hmm.
And when he gets there in Naples, Florida, he realizes that, that vehicle in front of him did miss the horned owl, but apparently he's been traveling the last hundreds of miles with an owl stuck in his truck's grill.
Oh, that's not good. That's not good.
Actually, the owl is alive.
Oh, really?
Yes.
The owl, the great horned owl,
is in the grill.
Yes.
Has been there for hundreds of miles.
Uh-huh.
And is alive. So he called the Conservancy of Southwest Florida.
Right.
Which sent a volunteer to help dislodge the bird.
Yes.
And now, Gray says, the bird did more damage to the truck than it did to itself.
Really?
Yeah.
Wowzers.
So this bird gets hit by a truck, travels hundreds of miles in the grill, and now is happy back in Florida there.
Yeah, well, at least he didn't get some sort of fine by transporting an animal that should have been somewhere to another where. You know, I got to tell you, at night, I've nearly hit owls. I don't know that I've ever hit one, at least not with the front of my truck. I might have gotten one with my exhaust pipes once.
Yeah.
But It scares the absolute tar out of you, Steve Emming, when an owl all of a sudden in the middle of the night appears right before your windshield.
Yeah.
It is like an apparition. It is scary, scary stuff. But I would rather be scared that way than having to figure out what to do to get a great horned owl out of the grill of my vehicle.
Yeah.
That would be a tough one. 570 WNAX.
We got Coach's Show upcoming.
Coach's Show.
Just a few minutes, and then Twins at 7.
That's right. We got you some sports coming up here on 570 WNAX. South Dakota State University gets a win. We'll see if the Twins can get a win, too. 570 WNAX.
You've always wanted to go to Washington, D.C., and Steve makes it easy. Fly away with me to our nation's capital and see all the sights. You'll tour the Capitol, see the White House, and enjoy the Supreme Court and Library of Congress. Witness the Holocaust Museum and visit Mount Vernon and Arlington Cemetery. You'll stay at a hotel close to the Lincoln Memorial, and you'll see all the monuments, memorials, and museums with your own eyes. Plus, an entire day in Philadelphia. Don't miss this trip. Details at WNEXTrips.com.
A roof covers 90% of what you own. It's important to get the right guy to put on your roof.
That's Corey Cummings with Mitchell Roofing and Siding. Making the process easy for you is what Mitchell Roofing does best.
One of the things I like to stress the most is to use a local contractor. If you go with Mitchell Roofing, we're here yesterday, here today, and we'll be here tomorrow.
Call Mitchell Roofing and Siding today at 996-8648. That's 996-8648.
Mitchell Roofing, where you'll see the proof in our guaranteed roof.
The Steffes Group has been selling everything from the latest combines, tractors, and tillable farm acreage to hay and livestock the Steffes way since 1960. You see, the Steffes way is about doing business and working with people the right way. It's about trust, commitments, responsibility, and all those principles that are important to us in the work and the services we provide folks like you. To find out more about the Steffes way, go to steffesgroup.com right now. The Steffes Group, selling land and the equipment to farm it. The Steffes way since 1960.
It's Small Business Month, and Dell Technologies and Windows are celebrating your unstoppable drive. Save up to 45% on powerful PCs with Windows 10 Pro to work from anywhere, plus top monitors and docks for the ultimate business setup, all with easy financing options through Dell Financial Services. Speak to a Dell Technologies advisor who can help you find the right business tech, server, storage, and cloud solutions at 877-ASK-DELL. That's 877-ASK-DELL for Small Business Month savings.
Twins baseball is back for the 2021 season. Are you ready to get live?
And it's gone! Target Field explodes!
Make sure we can prioritize your seat at Target Field by visiting twinsbaseball.com/season tickets today. With flexible ticket plans available, you'll want to make sure you're in our house for all the exciting Twins action.
Grand slam, Sano!
He is out!
Twins fans are here.
Baseball is back for the 2021 season.
Hawk & Company Ag of Alton, Iowa carries the Bunning line of manure spreaders. Large volume spreaders designed for large-scale farmers and contractors with high volume requirements. Like the new Lowpro 670 to 780 cubic foot manure spreader. Or the Lowlander Wideboy 230 and 380 spreaders with triple axle steerable, vertical beaters, spinner deck ready, and ISO bus variable rate scale system. Contact Hawk & Company Ag of Alton, Iowa and Slayton, Minnesota about the Bunning line of manure spreaders. Or check them out online at hawkag.com.
This is WNAX Yankton. Check out the impressive capability of the Ford F-150 at buyfordnow.com. It's 6 o'clock.
Good, how are you doing?
Yep, 50 seconds. We'll be right back.
on the Jackrabbit Sports Network from Learfield IMG College. This is the John Stiegelmeier Show, presented by Covey Sports Bar and Grill, a Brookings original and your Jackrabbit headquarters. Also brought to you in part by First Premier Bank, Premier Bank Card. Believe in possibility. Member FDIC. Sanford Health. Even in uncertain times, we're ready to see you. Learn more at sanfordhealth.org. Bud Light. Whenever there's a Jackrabbit game to watch, there's a Bud Light there. Your local Northland Ford dealers. Visit buyfordnow.com. First Bank and Trust. Because everyone should play hard and bank easy. And by Farm Credit Services of America. Call Farm Credit Services of America for your ag financing. Agriculture works here. Now, here is your host, Tyler Merriam.
Hi, friends, and welcome to the John Stiegelmeier Radio Show. It is the semifinal edition, as the Jackrabbits are one of the final four teams standing in the spring 2021 edition of the FCS playoffs. We will talk about that, and we will talk about an unbelievable game that occurred last night. For those of you watching behind us here at Dana J. Dykhouse Stadium, as the Jackrabbit football team defeated Southern Illinois to advance to the semis. I'm Tyler Merriam, the head coach of SDSU, John Stiegelmeier, alongside. You and I were joking before we came on and just discussing last night and the 31-26 win over the Salukis. And we were discussing just how we felt about it, the reaction to it. And you said you kind of had a piece about the whole situation.
I did. You know, I thought we had a great I knew we had a great week of preparation. And I wouldn't say I was guaranteeing a win, but I knew our guys were going to play hard. I could sense that, and they did. They did play. They found a place to play even harder in the second half. And so that's all you can do. And players, if you watch the sidelines, some of the coaches get riled up, and that's uneasy. That's unsettling for players. And so we all should be at peace on the sidelines. And you, at the end, felt like you've been through a workout, right?
I said that. I have called two games in my life where I've been physically sore at the end of them because I was just so tense, because you get, you know, you kind of bowl your neck, try not to make a mistake, be so focused and locked in, and you don't realize it till the adrenaline wears off, and you certainly don't have the adrenaline of an athlete when you're up here in the booth, but you do have a little bit of that. And I got home, and I was, you know, having dinner with my wife, and Jill and I were talking, and all of a sudden I'm like, I am sore. This just, you know, physically, just the shoulder. A good night's sleep, and I'm fine now. But it was a good night's sleep. I had a few hours sleep, yep. but it was sore. Speaking of which, before we talk about the game, did anybody leave the Dykhouse Student Athlete Center? Did any of the coaches leave last night after the game?
One did. Yeah.
Okay.
I went home.
You did.
I got to bed at 2.
Perks of a head coach.
2 a.m. and was up at 5:30. Our GAs, I was coming in early, like I said, and there was a car parked out here, and a couple guys gave each other a hug, and one got in, and it was Luke Munstertiger, one of our GAs, our offensive GA, and he hadn't gone home. Hmm. His brother had been at the game, came up to just say goodbye and so on. But that's the nature of that type of setup. I mean, you have to get ready for Delaware. You can't waste a day. We don't get an extra day. And so a lot of people worked hard. A lot of our coaches, because we didn't have a full breakdown, they watched the game. And I told them, put away, don't worry about it. But they want to watch the game because of the victory. So,
well, and I suppose, too, you got so much energy, you know. And that's always something I tell people when they ask about things is when the game gets over, you don't, and even me at a distance, you don't go back to your house or go back to the hotel and fall asleep right away. You've just got so much energy. You're going to be up for 2-3 hours anyway, so you might as well put yourself to work either reviewing the game or watching the next one, because, like you said, you're not – that game got done. You got press conference, other things. It's midnight. You're not just going to go straight to sleep. You're going to be wired for a while.
Yeah, well, I get home, and our oldest grandson was asleep because he had school online, but the 3-year-old and the 1-year-old, they were going strong at 12:45. So that was fun. That was fun, and they're all – they test, and they don't see people, so we're not being crazy. But that was fun to celebrate the victory. But you're right. You get home from something like that, and you don't want to go to bed. You want to just relax and think about it and enjoy it, win or loss, really.
Well, we'll get into all the particulars of this game here as this hour goes along. We're going to talk about the matchup with Delaware, which will be another nationally televised event, ESPN, at 11 a.m. Central Time on Saturday. Radio coverage starts at 10 a.m. throughout the Jackrabbit Sports Network, so we go from Sunday night to Saturday morning. But before we talk about all that, just in general, that game gets done, and you've been a part. The joke is, you know, when you have a veteran coach, they've seen everything. But you've been a part of some wild games that have been high scoring. Some low scoring, you know, 16-12 winning at Southern Illinois a few years ago with Sumner and the like. That game with what was on the line, the atmosphere, that's a pretty special win you had last night.
It was. I think that's one of the games that this team, when they get together, however they do, we'll talk about, you know, because there's a lot of exciting plays in it, the goal line stand. Those types of things, Mark's run. I mean, we'll talk about all this stuff, but and those things are frozen in your mind. I mean, those things you don't forget. But it was a good game, and you know, I think the awkwardness of it is, and we talked about this, and I told the team about this, and I told the press about this. You beat them 44-3. Everything goes our way, nothing goes their way, and on the road, and this is going to be an easy game. We knew that, and they were playing at a high level. Their quarterback was, at that time, was one of the best in the conference, if not the nation, and he showed that again last night. So it just ended up being a great football game against two really good football teams.
You said something in the post-game press conference, which, again, we talk about what we do. I'm laying in bed watching the post-game press conference because I can't get to sleep. And but you didn't put me to sleep. I want that on the record. I'm not saying that. But nevertheless, you're not a cure for insomnia, as my voice has sometimes been accused of being. However, you said afterwards, Jimmy Rogers came to you earlier this year. I don't know if you guys were talking in a team meeting or coaches meeting or whatever, but he made an interesting comment about this football team. What did he say?
Well, it's referenced about what we've accomplished and why. And Jimmy, who's been part of our football program for a long time as a player, GA, and now co-defensive coordinator, linebacker coach, he said, "Stig, this team is different." And we didn't go further, but I remembered that. And it's hard when you have 100 guys on the football team, and even more with the injured guys and staff and COVID and all that stuff, to say what to put your finger on one thing. And as I said again today, in a situation, and I really think one of the big differences is that they've bonded through one of the toughest times. To bond, all right? I mean, we've had done so few team activities, but they looked at each other in December and said, "We're coming back for 3 weeks." Went back home for a couple of days, said, "We're coming back for a week in January." And you don't have to sit down and play Yahtzee with somebody to say, "I'm committed to you. I'm committed to this mission." You just need to do things like that. And I think that's one of the things. And then great senior leadership. You know, obviously, Mark has created some type of unique excitement in our program because he's a freshman and he's playing really well. Life's an average. I want to remind him of that you know, he'll have some tough days too, and he'll have to battle through it. But it is different. I'm not saying we're going to win a national championship. We're focused on today and having a good practice tonight.
Well, we'll delve into the specifics of this win. There's so many important plays in this game, so many unsung heroes of this 31-26 win. We'll try to cover all of that. We got the Players of the Week coming up, a preview of Delaware, and much more. Cubby Sports Bar and Grill is the presenter of our show. And, of course, our postseason coverage is always brought to you by our friends at First Premier Bank and Premier Bank Card. The John Stiegelmeier Radio Show, coming to you live from Dana J. Dykow Stadium, returns in just a moment on the Jackrabbit Sports Network from Learfield IMG College.
Walk these fields for 8 decades. Grow deeper roots here. Know what thrives here. Bring in world-class genetics and innovative traits like Chrome Triple Stack Corn Hybrids and Enlist E3 soybeans. Refine it through pure local know-how and expertise. Do all of that, and the only thing left is the right seed. Pogemeyer Hybrids. Learn more at therightseed.com.
In South Dakota, farming is more than cornfields and combines. It's the small moments and big challenges we all face every day. It's getting up in the morning, taking care of what needs to be done, doing the best you can, and being thankful for the opportunity to do it again tomorrow. This is real. This is life. This is farming. To learn more about farming, visit thisisfarming.org.
brought to you by South Dakota Corn.
Cubby Sports Bar and Grill is your sports headquarters with more than 50 TVs providing the area's best sports viewing environment, including the NFL Sunday Ticket, ESPN College Extra, NHL Center Ice, and other sports packages. Plus daily food and drink specials, open to all ages daily at 11 and Saturdays at 10. Cubby Sports Bar and Grill, a Brookings original in downtown Brookings and a proud sponsor of the Jacks.
Becoming America's best-selling brand means you never settle. Like the Ford F-150, completely rebuilt from the ground up to be smarter and tougher than ever. Or the Ford Bronco Sport, with a legacy that can't be broken. The entire Bronco family is designed, engineered, and built for adventure. Plus, Ford's complete lineup of SUVs gives you the power, style, and space you need for life on the go. Go to buyfordnow.com or contact your local Northland Ford dealer for exclusive offers on the perfect Ford for you. Sales claim based on calendar year sales.
Here's a pop quiz for corn growers. Of the top three seed corn brands in the Central Corn Belt, only one is 100% focused on seed corn. U.S. farm family owned and got there without the help of a parent company. Any guesses? That's right. Wiffles Hybrids. Officially making them the grown-up in the field. Wiffles Hybrids. One thing done right.
30 seconds. The road to success is paved with hard work, dedication, and perseverance. It also requires a strong team and a common goal. First Premier Bank can help you achieve financial success using the same formula. Our associates take the time to know you, and you'll never receive cookie-cutter solutions. Visit firstpremier.com to learn more about our financial products and services. First Premier Bank and Premier Bank Card. Proud supporters of Jackrabbit Athletics. Member FDIC.
The John Stiegelmeier Radio Show continues on this Monday night from Dana J. Dykhouse Stadium, presented by Cubby's Sports Bar and Grill. Cubby's usually has a feature of the week, and that is one of the most anticipated portions of our show. We love to give you the in-depth description of those features because each and every one of them is even more mouth-watering and delicious than the previous one. However, Jeremy, Gus, and Chris and the crew down at Cubby's not doing a feature of the week this week. You know, they're in celebration mode because it's finals week. They want to honor all of the SDSU students. So we honor them along with Cubby's. We say thank you. Also, jacked up shirts all week are free with any other purchase, but limited sizes remain. And a thank you to all who have helped Cubby's get through this challenging time. Like, they hope they've been able to maybe give you a little joy and take a little something off your plate by putting something on your plate. Cubby's Sports Bar and Grill on Main Avenue in downtown Brookings.
That was good.
Thank you very much. We talked about thanking the students, and Cubby's has done that. We need to thank the fans who were here, particularly the students, because that's where it starts last night. It felt like, I tell you what, we've had crowds of 15,000 that didn't necessarily make an impact like the crowd that we had last night. That was unbelievable.
Excuse me for saying it, but that was a holy nutmeg. I mean, it was. When I heard the ticket sales, I thought, bummer for the administration, you know, and NCAA because of funds and stuff. But for me, it's about the impact. And they had unbelievable impact. I went home to my family at the end, and I said, what was going on? And they just said, everybody, as they saw it and heard it, was there to make a difference. And that's, you know, we don't want to criticize the 15,000 that come and maybe don't do that, but it's a great example that when we all do that, when everybody that's here does it, the impact it has at the end of the first half in terms of giving us energy, when it was tough times, the goal line stand, the two-minute drill, all those times they rose up and had an impact in the game.
Your defense was put to the test early and often in this game. And as we discussed, we anticipated that because Southern Illinois is such a wide-open, versatile attack. They can do so many things. And they had the ball for over 35 minutes in this game. In the first half, they built a lot of momentum. And you're down 20-7 late in the second quarter. But I think it bears repeating, your defense kept it 20-7 because against a lesser team, that game might have been over by halftime, but that defense found a way to force a couple of field goals and keep some light hanging out there at the end of the tunnel.
Yeah, you know, I talked to those guys during the game, halftime, after the game, and then specifically today. And they said when they run a play, when they ran a play that we had practiced, most of the time it was jokes over. We were successful, but they ran so much, they changed their offense so much that our guys were scrambling. Our coaching staff was scrambling a little bit in terms of rules and so on. And what we did at halftime, I think we really narrowed it down so we had these calls adjust to all this stuff, because all the trick plays, the formations, the Wildcats, all that stuff, you saw it. You tried to paint the picture. That puts pressure on some guys, and in the end, we end up winning the game.
And Southern Illinois, I guess it's a compliment to your defense as well that they thought, hey, we've got to pull off a lot of different things. We have to be even more unique in our offensive sets than we already are, because they like to run trick plays. And they ran a number of them. And you go back, the first two touchdowns, one of them is a 327-pound offensive lineman running the football up the middle, and the other is on a jet sweep reverse that three different guys touch the football on what turns out to be a running play. Right. And so they throw a lot of different wrinkles at you, but there also is that phrase of live by the sword, die by the sword, and they commit a big fumble trying to run a trick play as well. But what a compliment, I would say, is that how you view it, that they had to vary things so much because they didn't think that they could just conquer you straight up?
I think they did that offensively and defensively. Yeah. You know, we talked about earlier off the show that what they did to their defense or how they changed their defense. Yeah. And, you know, I credit to them. Ideally, this is built into our systems, but ideally your rules handle anything. You know, if they change the front, your zone blocking, your down blocking, that takes care of that. If they move their formations and they run a triple reverse, somebody's assigned to that in your defense. I don't think Coach Hill, who's does a great job and deserves a ton of credit, their head coach, I don't think he looks at a defense as much and says, let's attack it like this. He looks at the new play, the next step in the offense, and runs those plays and hopefully catches you.
Okay, we've talked about the offense, some of the things SIU did. From a defensive standpoint, let's quickly sidetrack there. There were times they're walking 6-7 men to the line of scrimmage, and I'm watching it from up here going, you have no idea which guys are coming. Are they going to run the guys in the middle to you? Are they going to run the guys to the side? Are they coming with all 7? Are they going to run 8? They certainly had a number of wrinkles in that defense, stuff that we hadn't seen from watching previous games.
Well, again, let's go back. We rushed for 392 yards against them the first time. So they were saying, when you have two tight ends on the field, you're not running the football. You know, we're going to have one extra guy there. And we still ran the football at times. That's where running the quarterback is so important. And so, I as a D coordinator, I thought it was cheating. I thought you should only get like 5 of those a game, because you don't count for that guy in the run game. But that's what they decided, and they, for the most part, they had success with it.
So, despite all this, you're down 20-7 late in the first half, final 25 seconds, and your kick return game has not done a great job this year, namely because for the most part you just let the balls go through the end zone. You haven't tried to return many kicks, so you haven't had many opportunities to be great. But Isaiah Davis takes a chance, gets a 50-yard kick return, then a quick hitter to Pierre Strong, and he catches the ball on a sharp little cut he makes a few yards downfield, then busts it for 20 more, puts you into field goal range, and you get that field goal from Cole Fromm on the last play of the half. So you're still down 10. But the difference, it just felt, from 13 to 10 was astronomical.
Well, you talk about going from the kickoff to getting 3 points in under 30 seconds, which we did in the first game, too. I think it was 39 seconds. We got a field goal. First of all, let's talk in general. We have worked two-minute drills so much this year. My father said, you work on something, you're going to get good at it. We've worked on it. We're pretty good at it. But that's our special situation also. You know, we're talking. You know, if it's a normal kickoff, it's at the 25, probably going to run the ball, see what happens. If we get a break, let's throw the ball and see if we can get in position. You know, we got the break. Let's give credit to the kickoff return guys that blocked the heck out of that. And Isaiah read it and got to the 50-yard line. And then I'll put the ball in Pierre's hands in the open field any day and good kick. But, yeah, going into the locker room, great momentum for us, even though we're behind by 10.
And then the third quarter is just a very unique 15 minutes of football, because Southern's getting the football. It's up 10. And you know what they're thinking? Hey, we go down, we punch this thing in, and we essentially won the football game. That's what's going through their minds. Let's go win this football game. A long drive, about 5 minutes. They get inside Jackrabbit territory. The defense holds on fourth down. They're not quite in field goal range, but they're too close to punt. Throw a pass to the end zone, and Manchegaya picks it off. And then, bam, you go right down the field. Four plays, score a touchdown. Now you're right back in the football game. And then they have one of these long drives again and run out the entire rest of the third quarter. So you only run four offensive plays in the third quarter. Talk about a taxing defensive effort that SIU required your defense to put up.
And to add to that, they're no huddle, so you don't get to substitute a bunch. You know, you really have to plan your substitutions when they substitute, because a game ago we got caught with too many guys on the field, and we've talked about that. So a credit to them, good game plan, simple game plan, run, wildcat, throw short passes. And then again, that quarterback, he threw some balls before the guys cut. And put them on the dime, put them on the spot. So, good football player.
All right, so you're down a score. They've got the football on a third down. You blitz everybody, and they have the perfect call for it. Hit Javon Williams out of the backfield. He ends up stepping out of bounds at the one-yard line late in the third quarter. They're looking at first and goal at the one, and you hit him backwards for a loss. You meet him at the line of scrimmage. You hold Labanowitz for a yard after he throws an incompletion on second down. You hold him for a yard on third down. Now it's fourth down and goal. You're switching sides to start the fourth quarter. And again, we talk about how they do some things. They keep everybody on the far sideline as long as they can. Then they come to the huddle. Everybody gets in the huddle. Then they sprint out of the huddle and try to snap the ball real quick and give it to the 327-pound kitchen appliance. And Furcron scored the first time. He doesn't score this time. Your defense rises up.
Huge, huge play in the game. Huge sequence. Let's go back to out at the one-yard line. Great effort by Josh Manchegaya to not allow him in the end zone. I've been part of two or three of those types of plays that end up winning you the football game. That really had a huge impact in the football game. But I haven't watched the film, like I said, but I'm looking forward to watch that goal line stand and see our guys rise up and keep him out of the end zone. And then what happened after that was really special.
27 plays for Southern Illinois. One of them's in the fourth quarter, but the rest all in the third. They ran 27 plays to year four. They gained 100. This is just remarkable. 115 yards, had the football for 13 minutes, and didn't score. Right. An interception and over on downs on that fourth down stop. We keep going back to it. The defense, what co-coordinators Bergstrom and Rogers did, that unit, that wins you the football game.
It does. It does. And I mean, the momentum from something like that. Now, I wish we could keep the guys on the sidelines and because we're going to get a penalty one of these days by everybody going out and celebrating. But that was true excitement for our defense and our football team.
All right. We've got so much to get to. We need to take a timeout. When we come back, we'll hit on the fourth quarter. We've got some other individual performances to highlight. We're going to preview the matchup with Delaware and much more coming up as the Jackrabbit football team defeating Southern Illinois 31-26 last night. Top-seeded SDSU will host Delaware at 11 a.m. on ESPN, and you can be here at Dana J. Dykhouse Stadium Wednesday at 7 a.m. Tickets will go on sale to the general public. Cubby Sports Bar and Grill presents the John Stiegelmeier Radio Show. Back with more in just a moment on the Jackrabbit Sports Network from Learfield, IMG College.
Cubby Sports Bar and Grill is your sports headquarters with more than 50 TVs providing the area's best sports viewing environment, including the NFL Sunday Ticket, ESPN College Extra, NHL Center Ice, and other sports packages, plus daily food and drink specials, open to all ages daily at 11 and Saturdays at 10. Cubby Sports Bar and Grill, a Brookings original in downtown Brookings and a proud sponsor of the Jacks.
At Wiffles Hybrids, our family recipe for success has been handed down for three generations. Take two parts high-performing hybrids, mix with one part unmatched quality, then finish it off with our secret sauce, superior customer service. Some people may say it's impossible to get the best hybrids from an independent, family-owned company, to which we'd say, have your cake and eat it too. Wiffles Hybrids, quite possibly the best hybrids you can buy.
It's back, the return of the prestigious Learfield IMG College Director's Cup, honoring college sports excellence across all competitive divisions, both men's and women's sports. Follow along with L Director's Cup on Twitter or online to see which schools will be taking home a first-place trophy in June for their season-long success. Learfield IMG College Director's Cup, a premier institutional award jointly launched in 1993 by USA Today and NACTA.
The past year, we've taken some things for granted, such as the importance of a consistent food supply chain, gathering in large groups, and the fall football season. Just as SDSU football is innovating to offer spring football games, so too is the ag industry constantly innovating to provide a safe and reliable supply of affordable and healthy food for your family's table. South Dakota Farm Bureau's game plan is to find wins for agriculture by supporting the industry through policy development and advocacy. South Dakota Farm Bureau, a proud supporter of SDSU athletics. Go Jacks!
In South Dakota, farming is more than cornfields and combines. It's the small moments and big challenges we all face every day. It's getting up in the morning, taking care of what needs to be done, doing the best you can, and being thankful for the opportunity to do it again tomorrow. This is real. This is life. This is farming. To learn more about farming, visit thisisfarming.org. Brought to you by South Dakota Corn.
Becoming America's best-selling brand means you never settle. Like the Ford F-150, completely rebuilt from the ground up to be smarter and tougher than ever. Or the Ford Bronco Sport, with a legacy that can't be broken. The entire Bronco family is designed, engineered, and built for adventure. Plus, Ford's complete lineup of SUVs gives you the power, style, and space you need for life on the go. Go to buyfordnow.com or contact your local Northland Ford dealer for exclusive offers on the perfect Ford for you. Sales claim based on calendar year sales.
Let's be real. You earn, you save, you plan, you protect. If you want to secure your legacy, First Bank and Trust offers savvy financial planning from people who understand where you are and where you want to go. We can help you navigate your options and build for the future, whatever that may be. We're big enough to help you plan for tomorrow and small enough to start with today. First Bank and Trust. Real banking, real easy. Member FDIC, Equal Opportunity Lender.
30 seconds.
Midco Sports Network is proud to bring fans live regional sports coverage. No matter what this season brings, our goal to provide the best local sports coverage remains.
Oh! Jackson, Winicky's got himself open out of the middle.
From the field to your screen, Midco Sports Network brings you the best in regional sports coverage.
Touchdown, Jackrabbits!
Midco SN, celebrating 10 years of sports.
The John Stiegelmeier Radio Show coming to you live from Dana J. Dykow Stadium. We're on the sixth floor of the West Tower of this beautiful palace on the prairie. I'm Tyler Merriam, along with the head coach of SDSU. Holy Nutmeg is the Twitter handle. We just call him Coach Stig. He's John Stiegelmeier, the pride of Selby. Today's show is presented by Cubby Sports Bar and Grill, and our entire postseason coverage of Jackrabbit football during the Spring 2021 campaign, courtesy of our friends at First Premier Bank and Premier Bank Card. And Coach, we have talked about the first three quarters of football. Let us touch on the fourth quarter. And so you get the goal line stop, but you're down a score at this point. And everybody will remember the Gronowski touchdown. And we'll get to that in a moment. But there is a pivotal play that leads up to that. Third down and eight from your own three-yard line, and you call a screen pass to Jackson Yonke, and the move he makes, the blockers, and he gets downfield. I think it's 24 yards when it's all said and done. But one of those forgotten plays in the course of a game, that was huge.
You don't get the first down, you're punting. They have great field position. They have the momentum back. It was huge, and a good call by Coach Eck. You know, some of the coaches in the box said, "What?" and but it turned out, and that's Jackson has made a lot of plays on that slip screen, and it's hard to defend. Our guys do a good job of blocking it, and again, like you said, huge play in the game.
And he's such a physical runner after the catch as well, where Pierre is so good just with his speed. Not that Jackson doesn't have speed, but I think he's deceptively physical for some cornerbacks and defensive backs.
I agree, because I think he's – I mean, he doesn't look like a weightlifter, but he's very strong. He's worked very hard and continues to work hard.
And we should mention, I mean, Jaden Yonke had two touchdown receptions for the second straight game in the playoffs, and what Jackson did – They're playing with heavy hearts this past weekend, too. You know, grandma passes away, and that's a very emotional situation. To come out and play the way they did says a lot about who they are.
Well, they're young men that can walk off the football field and totally focus on chemistry or the family or whatever. Very strong mentally, and go to the football field and separate everything and lock in football. And I've never been one to tell a guy you need to do this or that in a tough situation. That's their call and the family's call, and glad they were there.
Well, just under 12 minutes remaining after that screen pass. You're looking at a third down from your own 33-yard line, and Mark Gronowski takes off on a run, gets hit near the line of scrimmage, had to break a tackle, and then it becomes a foot race. They have a safety that runs all the way across the field and almost gets Gronowski, but he stays on his feet. So the balance, the physicality, the speed, everything in the package that is Mark Gronowski was on display on a 67-yard touchdown run, and we talked about it afterwards, and I'm sure you'll agree. That's a play that's – I'm getting goosebumps just talking about it. That's a play that's going to stick with Jackrabbit fans for years to come.
It is, and if that one goes up on the wall of the greatest victories, that play will be highlighted. Yeah. That maybe that sequence will be highlighted. But, you know, Mark, if you number one, he looks it doesn't look like a necessarily a quarterback. It looks like he could play linebacker, really. He's a big, strong guy. He's deceptively fast. He understands, if you remember, I think it was his press conference, he talked about having his legs up at the end because he knew that's the way how people tackle him, is try to get his ankles. It's just a really – and here's a true freshman in what, his eighth game at the college level. So really impressed with him. Right now it's do or die. You know, you got to win to move on. So we're not going to spare any plays or anything, and we'll use him in the run game.
We hit a little on it earlier. They try to run a gadget play just across midfield, fumble. You recover, cash in for a touchdown. You're up 31-20 with 7 minutes left, but we talked about it up here too. You know this game's not over because of how SIU operates its offense. Quick strike, go down the field, score. Now it's 31-26 after they fail on a two-point conversion try. So 5:37 left. You have a chance to run out the clock, run the football, get a first down, decide to try one pass play, and it just happened to fail in the most spectacular way possible. It's not just an incomplete pass, but it happens to be a long sack that Gronowski hangs onto the football. But when you line things up, you don't always think of the absolute worst thing that could happen. I guess he didn't fumble, but other than that, that was. And now you have to punt. And you're without your normal punter in Ben Dinkel. Hunter Dustman was underwhelming in his first two punts, but he stepped up and gave you a big punt and put SIU deep in its own territory.
He did, and they came after it. They went after it. We did a pretty good job of blocking. He got a great punt off. Let's go back to the sequence in offense. So yeah, we were going to run the ball out, try to run the timeout, try to get a score. And I should have put my foot down. You know, I've got a head coach. And we should have just used more time in the plays. You know, we have a four-minute concept that says it's a special situation where you snap the ball with 2 seconds left on the clock, and who cares about scoring? If there's no time left in the game, you win. And the play action pass coach called, that's the first thing he said when I saw him on the field. Yeah, I shouldn't have called it. And I said, hey, we won, we learned, let's move on. So but a great punt, great coverage, and then put them into their two-minute drill.
So they're in the two-minute drill. They move down the field, put themselves in a position. They're inside Jackrabbit territory, and can't say enough about the effort of Michael Griffin II, what he did throughout the course of this football game. Early on that drive, he barely gets up after a tackle. I didn't know if he'd be able to stay in the game, but he does, and just keeps churning away. I know he had to come out a couple of times, and he jumps up over a receiver, makes a tremendous athletic interception, and then falls on the turf, gets mobbed by people. I'll be honest, I wasn't 100% sure it was Griffin for about 30 seconds because there's just this mob scene, and somewhere at the bottom of that pile is a guy with a pig skin, and you're hoping he's alive, Michael Griffin II, to seal it.
Well, I'm going to use that this week because Michael Griffin gave everything he had to his teammates. That's hard to do. Yeah. That's really hard to do, and he was spent. You know, that effort ball we give out that's deflated, that gave everything to Jackrabbit football, that was Michael Griffin. And we had a number of guys play like that, but Michael took it to the next level, and I was surprised at how high he went to go up to get the ball when as tired he was, but big play in the game.
Southern Illinois ran 80 plays in this game, and to put things in the proper perspective here when we're talking about all this is that they ran 48 plays in the second half. You ran 49 total So they ran so many plays in that second half. It's a Sunday night game. Now you're going to turn around and play on Saturday morning. We're not talking about broken legs here, but there is a level of physicality of this game. That's a lot of healing that has to be done in a shorter amount of time than normal.
Yeah, and I met with Charlie Miller, our trainer, athletic trainer, early, and I said, this is my plan. I want you to tell me what the health of our football team is. Our guys started coming in at 9 o'clock. It's finals week also, so our guys are taking finals, which they don't flinch about. So he said we're going to stick with it, and we're going to do one less day of pads. We'll get our guys back. And I think Delaware had a lot of tough plays too, physical plays too. They have to travel. We don't. So there's a lot of positives to our situation.
All right. We'll talk more. We'll wrap things up on this conversation about Southern Illinois and talk a little about the semifinal opponent. That is Delaware. When you come back, First Premier Bank and Premier Bank Card is our postseason presenter of Jackrabbit football coverage. And the John Stiegelmeier Radio Show is brought to you by Cubby's Sports Bar and Grill right here on the Jackrabbit Sports Network from Learfield IMG College.
Let's be real. You dream it. You start it. You build it. You grow it. That's what makes this such a great business community. As a community bank, First Bank and Trust is empowered to make local decisions with creative solutions, top-notch online banking, and cash management options. That means no matter the size of your business, we're big enough to help you take your next steps and small enough to get you started with your first. First Bank and Trust. Real banking. Real easy. Member FDIC. Equal opportunity lender.
Spend more moments in the moment, not in pain, with orthopedics and sports medicine care from Sanford Health. Our team is here to help you overcome joint issues, athletic injuries, and anything else holding you back. Experience care available when you need it, treatment options that go beyond the expected, and a plan that is made just for you. So together, we can find your way forward. Learn more at sanfordhealth.org.
Walk these fields for 8 decades. Grow deeper roots here. Know it thrives here. Bring in world-class genetics and innovative traits like Chrome Triple Stack Corn Hybrids and Enlist E3 soybeans. Refine it through pure local know-how and expertise. Do all of that, and the only thing left is the right seed. Pogemeyer Hybrids. Learn more at therightseed.com.
In South Dakota, farming is more than cornfields and combines. It's the small moments and big challenges we all face every day. It's getting up in the morning, taking care of what needs to be done, doing the best you can, and being thankful for the opportunity to do it again tomorrow. This is real. This is life. This is farming. To learn more about farming, visit thisisfarming.org. Brought to you by South Dakota Corn.
Jax, we are proud of you. Prostrallo Auto Mall in Madison is proud to be a strong supporter of SDSU Athletics. We know hard work and determination make for a winning team. So when you buy from Prostrallo's, you will experience our winning team. We will do our very best to find the perfect car or truck and even deliver it to your front door. Find the savings and selection you deserve at Prostrallo Auto Mall in Madison. South Dakota strong for 63 years. Go Jax!
30 seconds.
Looking to gain traction on the competition before the next harvest? Spring into savings with end-user instant rebates, where you can get up to $150 back on each Michelin Ag tire you buy at WW Tire. The best part is, there's no quantity limits, so the more you buy, the more you save. Hurry and get in on the savings, because this offer is valid now through May 15th. WW Tire, delivering fast and friendly service across 8 locations in South Dakota.
The John Stiegelmeier Radio Show, starring John Stiegelmeier. So it should be no surprise that John Stiegelmeier is here. He's the head coach. I'm Tyler Merriam. It's great to have you with us. The SDSU football team, the number one seed in the Football Championship Subdivision Spring 2021 playoffs. And the Jacks are in the semifinals against Delaware on Saturday afternoon. The other side of the bracket will feature the 2 and 3 seeds, as that side was all chalk. It is Sam Houston playing host to James Madison. 11 a.m. is the kickoff on Saturday. It'll be on ESPN. 10 a.m. our coverage begins on this same station. We'll have an hour pregame show, as we always do, or on the Jackrabbit app. Stick can tell you how that works, or on gojacks.com/watch. In addition to all of that, tickets will be available to the general public beginning on Wednesday morning. You can go to jackrabbittickets.com, call the SDSU ticket office at 688-5422 and purchase your opportunity to be a part of what you have described so often as history.
History, yeah. Well, it is. I mean, number one seed, first time ever, hosting a semifinal game. It comes with the first number one seed, you know, chance to go to the an opportunity to go to the championship and compete for a national championship, which people say that all the time, but two teams get to go every year, and not a lot of teams ever get to go or have an opportunity. So we need them here. You know, we need that 50%. We need those tickets bought. We need those people to come like the last group did and have an impact.
Third time in the last 4 years in the FCS semifinals, but as you said, first time here at Dana J. Dykhouse Stadium. Players of the week, the scout teamers, and also those who competed last night.
Yeah, some interesting ones. Kinzer Madison is our scout offensive player. He's a linebacker.
Sure.
But he played number 15.
That's 2 weeks in a row now we've had a defensive player be the scout offensive player of the
week.
Right,
right. They've stepped up in unique situations to be able to run what we need. And so he was the Wildcat. He was number 15.
Javon linebacker. Williams.
Yeah. Scout defense, Caleb Francel has done a phenomenal job all year long. Another special one, scout special teams, Landon Wolf. Landon Wolf in the fall played wide receiver for Oklahoma State and played a lot of football. Mm-hmm. He transferred here, and now he's our scout team special teams guy because he's ineligible. Talk about a servant's heart. Offensively, Mark Gronowski and Aaron Johnson. Defensively, Don Gardner, who played some good football. Special teams, Isaiah Davis for his return. Specifically, and then effort was Wes Jeanette. We had more guys nominated for effort in this game, twice as many guys effort nominated as we did the game before, which says our guys stepped up.
I'm going to take a bone of contention with the special teamer, and not because Isaiah Davis is not deserving, but with Ben Dinkle out with an ankle, and he should be back next week. Is that what
should.
I understand?
Yep, yep.
Okay. So, yes, you have a different punter, but people forget you also have a different holder. And Keaton Heidi had some challenging holds. There was a high snap. There was a one hop. And I thought Heidi did a spectacular job in getting everything down. And I know Fromm misses the one. I didn't think that was on Heidi. I thought for somebody who hasn't held in a game all spring, I thought he performed admirably.
He did. He did. And we have him listed as a difference maker play.
Okay.
On the one low one, he got up. And
well, there was one too. He reached over his head, I remember, too. It wasn't unbelievably high, but he had to go up and get it. I mean, I thought he did really well.
Yeah, and we practice that every week, but he hadn't done it in a game. And it's nice to see him step up like that. And I'm sure that makes Ben hungry to be able to get back out there and do his thing. So.
Absolutely, it does. Some other names that we need to discuss in this contest. Three names. Blake Coons, Tucker Kraft, Zach Hines, those three together. And I'm not sure if folks realize that part of the reason here that you've had such a surge in your rushing game is because those three are on the field together. And, yes, they're capable of big plays in the passing game. And you look, Coons had a 30-yard catch and Kraft had a 31-yarder last night, and both are big plays. But those three all together on the field. The 605 Hogs have done a great job, but those three blocking have been a huge reason why that running game has been as electric as it's been lately.
Yeah, there's no doubt. We made the commitment early. We thought we'd be playing in snow. We never really had a tough weather game, but we made the commitment, and they rose up. You know, Zach Hines, just an unbelievable football player, didn't get a catch again. But when you throw him the ball, he's going to make the play. And, you know, honestly, we almost have too many good tight ends, and that can't happen, but it's hard to spread the ball out, but we use them in the run game a ton.
Defensively, you mentioned Don Gardner. Gardner has six tackles, three of them solo, three of them are assisted. He comes up with a pass breakup too, but just you could just see the impact he has. And he's got that charisma. Gronowski has that on offense, you know, like you talked about. It seems like Gardner has that on defense.
He does, and I think it's taken him a little bit to really believe totally in himself, but he's having so much success right now. I mean, everybody's going to make a mistake here and then, but he played a really good football game. I mean, he de-cleated a guy in one of his tackles.
Yeah.
He weighs 175 pounds, so he brought it all in that football game.
I know it's a bear of a task trying to cover Landon Lenore and Avante Cox, the best 1-2 punch, at least statistically, as far as wide receivers go in the Valley. I would say Jaden and Jackson would argue that point, and rightfully so. But trying to cover those two is a tough task. They made some big plays in the pass game. How did you feel that the secondary performed in pass coverage?
I thought we could be better. I was disappointed in the third and a little over medium, the third, six, seven, eight, where they got the uncontested out or slant or curl. Now, Malik got hurt in the game and came back out and tried to play, and he shouldn't have done that because he wasn't healthy enough. But I love that type of commitment. But I think we need to be more challenging. Now, you take that statement with a grain of salt, because go stand in front of those guys in the line of scrimmage and cover them all over. That's tough also. But I was disappointed in that, especially in the first half.
And to your point, Southern Illinois was 6 of 8 on third and medium in the game. They were actually better on third and medium than they were on third and short.
Sure. Yep.
But one other thing about just the way this game played out is the impact of the crowd, and we've touched on that and what they can do. But I just thought top to bottom, there were so many individual plays and so many individual players in a game like this. You don't look at defense and say, well, Logan Backus won you this game or Adam Bach won you this game, but you had one play. Xavier Ward obviously steps up when the opportunity is there and dives out of football. Sanders comes up with a big play in the backfield. We could certainly sing the praises of the Gardeners and the box up and down. We talked about the two tight ends each making the one significant catch. You had so many guys that made a play when called upon.
Well, and again, we have a good football team.
Yeah.
We have a lot of good football players, and so there were some years where we said, Cade, we're going to get you the ball 3 out of 4 times and we're going to move you around and so on. And with this football team, that's really hard to defend because we have a lot of good players. And we play a lot of guys on defense, and they rise up. I think the two safeties with the two interceptions, those are huge plays.
Yep.
In the football game. And Caleb had the tackle for a loss. The fumble recovery was huge, all those things. But bottom line is probably the biggest play in the game was Manchigaya pushing the guy out at the one-yard line and saving points.
And I'm going to just take a shot in the dark here before we wrap up this segment. I know that Preston Tetzlaff had 3 tackles in the game. I'm just going to guess the moment that he will put as his favorite from this one was fielding the ground ball off to his right on the opening kickoff and then sprinting forward, breaking a tackle, and getting 12 yards and a kick return.
Well, I love Preston. I do. I say that in all seriousness.
I sense a butt coming here.
No. We practiced that. We knew they squibbed. That was part of their mentality. And so Coach Sleissner did a good job of us practicing it individually and then scheming it. And the whole concept is it's a short kick, set short, go get a hat on somebody, and don't dance on a squib or a lob, get upfield. Preston, the 2 times he got it in practice, I believe he ran all the way to the goal line both times. Nobody contested him, so he was going to do whatever he could in that situation.
I was going to say, I don't envision Preston Tetzlaff being much of a dancer. He is the straight-ahead,
yep.
downhill runner that you like. Anything else on SIU?
No, I just I'm excited to have won the game, give them a lot of credit. That's a good football team. And I think it's become kind of a unique rivalry for us long distance, but respect them, and I'm glad we're still playing.
Now, Southern Illinois has nothing to be ashamed of. Nick Hill and that program, what an unbelievable effort last night. It's a shame either team had to lose that game, but I don't think John Stiegelmeier's giving this one back, are you?
Nope.
You're going to keep
nope.
it? All right. Jacks are in the semifinals. It's Delaware on Saturday at 11 a.m. We'll talk about the Blue Hens, a program that the Jacks have played, I'll say recent history, but it has been 11 years. We'll talk about that in the matchup on Saturday when the John Stiegelmeier Radio Show continues, presented by Cubby Sports Bar and Grill. Stick around. This is the Jackrabbit Sports Network from Learfield, IMG College.
Becoming America's best-selling brand means you never settle. Like the Ford F-150, completely rebuilt from the ground up to be smarter and tougher than ever. Or the Ford Bronco Sport, with a legacy that can't be broken. The entire Bronco family is designed, engineered, and built for adventure. Plus, Ford's complete lineup of SUVs gives you the power, style, and space you need for life on the go. Go to buyfordnow.com or contact your local Northland Ford dealer for exclusive offers on the perfect Ford for you. Sales claim based on calendar year sales.
Here's a pop quiz for corn growers. Of the top 3 seed corn brands in the Central Corn Belt, only one is 100% focused on seed corn. U.S. farm family owned and got there without the help of a parent company. Any guesses? That's right. Wiffles Hybrids. Officially making them the grown-up in the field. Wiffles Hybrids. One thing done right.
In South Dakota, farming is more than cornfields and combines. It's the small moments and big challenges we all face every day. It's getting up in the morning, taking care of what needs to be done, doing the best you can, and being thankful for the opportunity to do it again tomorrow. This is real. This is life. This is farming. To learn more about farming, visit thisisfarming.org. Brought to you by South Dakota Corn.
Spend more moments in the moment, not in pain, with orthopedics and sports medicine care from Sanford Health. Our team is here to help you overcome joint issues, athletic injuries, and anything else holding you back. Experience care available when you need it, treatment options that go beyond the expected, and a plan that is made just for you. So together, we can find your way forward. Learn more at sanfordhealth.org.
What does your small business want from a healthcare plan in these changing times? You want employees to have access to the largest network of doctors. You want flexible plans to fit your needs and your budget. But mostly, you want peace of mind, knowing your employees and company will be taken care of. It's why 8 out of 10 small businesses choose Wellmark Blue Cross and Blue Shield. See how we can help you take control. Find your best plan at wellmark.com/business.
Okay, Jax fans, let's make some noise.
Go, Jax!
Okay, Jax fans, normally Keep Farmers Farming Manager Alan Hoyer would be cheering about how South Dakota farmers can secure their legacies for generations to come with a little thoughtful financial planning. But when he's at a Jax game, the only banking Alan does is bank some noise.
Go, Jax!
Bank some noise with us at firstdakota.com, member FDIC.
Whether you're buying or selling your home, turn to the dedicated team of professionals at Century 21, Krogman & Company. Century 21 is a proud member of Jack's Home Team and is the preferred real estate partner of Jackrabbit Athletics. Check them out today at century21brookings.com. Or for more information on Jack's Home Team, visit gojacks.com/home team.
As locally grown organizations, First Premier Bank and Premier Bancard are committed to the communities they serve. You'll find their associates cheering for the Jacks, volunteering at events, and supporting local charities. You'll also find them helping their friends and neighbors achieve financial success. First Premier Bank and Premier Bancard, proud supporters of South Dakota State University Jackrabbit Athletics. Member FDIC.
The John Stiegelmeier Radio Show is presented by Cubby Sports Bar and Grill. With the head coach, I'm Tyler Merriam. We've got about 6 minutes here to talk about the opponent on Saturday, the Blue Hens of Delaware, co-champions out of the Colonial Athletic Association, or the CAA, and they are undefeated on the season, and they come into Brookings 11 a.m. on Saturday. Again, tickets go on sale to the general public Wednesday at 7 a.m. at jackrabbittickets.com. Have you had much time yet to really dig into Delaware like I know that your coaching staff has?
I started that early this morning, and then the other jobs built up, and I got back to it just before I got over here, and I'll start back after practice tonight.
Okay, so from talking to your staff, the little you have been able to look at, because, again, you had a football game you played less than 24 hours ago, what are your initial impressions of this undefeated team from Newark, Delaware?
I think the first thing is they're physical, both on defense and offense. The little bit I've seen is, I mean, they hit you, and the running game can be physical. Their quarterback's a winner. You know, I got more of that watching their game on TV prior to our game. I just thought he was a real competitor and led the team and did some good things. Defensively, they give you a bunch of looks. They're an odd front with five defensive backs. They call them different names, but I call them five defensive backs. So are they going to be in this or that or the other thing? And so throwing the ball is going to be a little tougher, just in the sense of pre-snap read and so on. But obviously they're undefeated. They're a CAA team. They're a good football team.
You said they're undefeated. They're a CAA team. Why is that so important?
I think that's one of the better leagues in the nation. You know, I think it's us and CAA and the Big Sky are the teams that get multiple people into the playoffs, which I think is your objective stance to say these are the better leagues, you know. And honestly, there's two CAA teams left, right? Them and James Madison, and there's one Missouri Valley team left. So both those teams are good football teams.
Delaware is second in the nation in scoring defense and fourth in the nation in total defense. So they are a team definitely built on its defense. And you talk about the quarterback. His name is Nolan Henderson. And tough hombre might be the way to describe him. You brought that up a little bit. He has a 300-pound lineman drive him into the ground on his non-throwing shoulder, leaves the game for one series in their quarterfinal round road win at Jacksonville State, who was undefeated, by the way. And then he comes back in and takes a vicious hit in the third quarter. It gets called for targeting, just a vicious hit. And he stays in the game and just keeps trucking along. And you know he's beat up. You know he took some Advil after that game. But to hang in like he did, I mean, you have to have respect for a guy like that.
Well, you do. I do. But think about what that does for your teammates when they see one of your leaders like that rise up and say, let's go, man. And he's kind of taped together. I think they talked about using every Band-Aid in the box take care of his shoulder. But those are the kind of guys you win with because they lead you and they make plays.
And Dajon Lee is the running back who was actually the offensive player of the year in the CAA. We talk about Henderson, who's very efficient throwing the football. But again, you see they're very good at forcing turnovers. They don't tend to make a lot of turnovers, so they're a little more conservative in their approach. But when you have a defense like that, similar to your offense, when you have that good of a defense, you don't need to be running triple reverse passes. You're going to stick with your bread and butter because it works.
Yeah, you know, they're a good football team, you know, and again, defensively, they're very physical. You said they have a bunch of takeaways. I wasn't aware of that. I do know I looked up this one kid. They call him Jack or Zach or whatever. I mean, he's 6'4", 225 pounds. He's lined up at safety. Now, that's a big man. And he rolls down, plays linebacker or strong safety or whatever. And they've got a lot of guys like that on their football team.
I think you're talking about the cat. They have a cat, and they have a bandit position on top of the traditional Mike and Will linebackers. And then they have two safeties and two defensive backs is how they list them. So it's always interesting to see the verbiage and how everybody goes about that. We got about a minute left here. This is a significant game for your program. I mean, obviously, it's a home game in the semifinals, but you look at everything you've accomplished. Frisco is the one thing your team has not been able to get to, and they've been so close a couple of times. There's a lot on the line on Saturday.
And our players know that. They know they worked hard and put themselves in this situation. They know what the goal is. They also know they're playing for the teams before them and the teams that come after them. And that we've always said that. So we'll go out. But we got to win today. You know, we can't think about that, the pressure. Our Chris Kroc will do a great job of preparing our guys and talking about keys and so on. But it is a big game, maybe one of the biggest because we're at home and we're the number one seed. But let's play one play at a time.
Well, again, we talked about the unique preparation for Sunday night. Now you got the early Saturday kickoff. I know you'd much rather be playing Saturday morning than Sunday night.
Right, I would. But it's very similar to UND. UND was a 12 o'clock game. This is an 11 o'clock game. So we just move everything up an hour. And the whole thing is make sure they're rested during the week. Make sure we're not wearing them out. So when they're getting up Saturday morning, they have a bounce in their step and they're not drained.
Well, Coach, should be a fun Saturday here at Dana J. Dykhouse Stadium. Thanks, as always, and good luck.
Thanks.
All right, so 11 a.m. is the kick. Tickets go on sale 7 a.m. Wednesday to the general public at jackrabbittickets.com. It's SDSU and Delaware in the FCS semifinals. Won't you join us? For the head coach, I'm Tyler Merriam. We'll see you next time on the Jackrabbit Sports Network. From Learfield, IMG College.
The John Stiegelmeier Show, presented by Cubby Sports Bar and Grill, a Brookings original, and your Jackrabbit headquarters. Also brought to you in part by First Premier Bank, Premier Bank Card, Believe in Possibility, Member FDIC, Sanford Health. Even in uncertain times, we're ready to see you. Learn more at sanfordhealth.org. Bud Light. Whenever there's a game to watch, there's a Bud Light there. Your local Northland Ford dealers. Visit buyfordnow.com. First Bank and Trust, because everyone should play hard and bank easy. And by Farm Credit Services of America. Call Farm Credit Services of America for your ag financing. Agriculture works here. The preceding has been a Learfield IMG College presentation of the Jackrabbit Sports Network.